What's going on, everyone? This is Steve Place from investingwithoptions.com, and today we're going to talk about the current tech market and how a combination of two different things lead me to believe that we're about to see a pretty decent-sized rug pull. So the first thing we have to understand is how options work and how market makers work when they provide liquidity. So what we'll do is we'll just head over to this nice, lovely MS Paint chart. Now, I want you to consider, let's just say that this is Apple, right? And let's say that you want to buy a call, and let's just say for now that this is a 30 delta call. So it's right around here. All right. So when you buy that, it is long delta, so long directional exposure, and it's also long gamma. And what that means is if Apple rallies, if it goes up, your delta also goes up. Your directional exposure increases. So if this option, which is out of the money, if it goes to at the money, all of a sudden your delta increases from 30 to 50, which is nice. If you're buying calls and then the stock rallies and then it rallies some more, it's a way that you basically add to a winner as the stock rallies. Okay. Now that's part one. Part two is you have to consider the person on the other side of the trade. So let's just say that this is a retail order. All right. And then you have the market maker on the other side. And it's going to be the same sort of thing. It's a 30 delta call right here. And then the market maker has to take the other side. And so that means they are ending up net short 30 delta. Now, market makers generally don't want to go home with directional exposure. So what they'll do is they'll find a way to balance out this trade. And they will go and find a way to buy 30 shares of the stock, or they'll balance it out with some short puts, or if they're on the other side, some long calls from people who are selling call options. This normally works. This interplay normally works, and the market makers will be paid well enough to provide liquidity to people who are market takers, who retail, or people who are speculating on these options. Now, every once in a while, what happens is that you get so many of these calls, you get so many people buying calls that it ends up skewing the market. And we see what I call a convexity squeeze, right? So let's say, for example, we're looking at this 30 delta option again, and then the market maker ends up net short 30 delta. All right. And that's going to be a triangle for delta. What if Apple rallies? Well, it goes from 30 to 50, right? So they've already zeroed out this short call by getting effective exposure in something. And what happens is that as Apple rallies, they end up more net short. And so they have to find a way to buy 20 more shares or 20 more deltas somewhere. When that adjustment comes through, it adds fuel to the fire. And if there is enough speculative calls going on, then you will see a convexity squeeze. And what will happen is that as a stock rallies, it will continue to see more call buyers and market makers get on the wrong foot. And they're forced to basically up the bid and up the ask and increase the implied volatility, especially on the call side of things, to justify the risk that they have to take of getting run over. So the most clear example was the run in Tesla, where it ran from, we're looking at post-split prices now, but it ran from, what was it, something like $450 all the way to $1,000, and that's pre-split prices. What we saw here, let's just say you were right here and you bought some out-of-the-money calls, and then the market maker ends up net short delta. But because they're also short gamma, what will happen is that the market will rally and then they have to buy something. It's effectively a short squeeze. It's the same kinds of mechanics as a short squeeze, but it is amplified if the stock just continues to be a freight train, gets more speculative action, and a lot of short vol traders and short calls and all those kinds of things got absolutely blown out. All right. So we've seen examples of upside risk. And there are a lot of people that lost a lot of money saying, oh, the implied volatility and the option premiums justify me selling them. Well, that worked until we saw this two-day move right here. And then the dam finally broke. Okay. So on individual stocks, it happens every once in a while, right? Tesla is a good example. You can go back in time and you can look at things like Alibaba and GoPro and some high beta tech names that will tend to run. And when they go parabolic, you will see two things. You will see the stock price go up and you'll also see the implied volatility go up because of the nature of convexity, the nature of how options work into a rally and the structure of how the market makers have to operate. Again, in a normal market, market makers are pretty balanced and they can, you know, you got people buying calls, you got people buying puts and selling calls and selling puts, and it's kind of balanced and they have a pretty good feel for when to balance it out. And in a perfect world, market makers would also be flat convexity, but that's just not how it works when an individual stock gets so out of whack, gets so unbalanced that you see this kind of squeeze higher, okay? So it happens. It happens sometimes. What is different about right now is you've got two different things going on. The first thing is that we had a crash in March, and we didn't just have a downside crash. We had a crash in everything. And then we had an upside crash, right? So if you sold puts, you got run over. If you sold calls, you got run over. If you sold vol in any way until about June, you got run over. If since July, if you've been selling vol, you've gotten run over. Not necessarily because the actual volatility in the market is high, and it's not. It's very, very low, but the nature of the volatility is trending. We're not seeing, you know, you can have high volatility as long as it's going sideways, and you can make money by doing selling straddles or selling iron condors or things like that. But if we have low volatility, but it's all in the same direction, that's where it can get in a lot of trouble. All right, so we know that a lot of firms in March got blown out. There were a lot of traders who were short vol, short variance, long treasuries, short treasuries, risk parity. All these trades just absolutely got smoked. All right, and then we saw this huge V-shaped rally with very few pullbacks involved. And the risk also can happen to the upside, especially if you are a net option seller. There are not as many investors and traders and market participants who are willing to sell options anymore because those that like to sell options got blown out in March and probably May and probably August, and they don't have the capital or the means to easily sell vol. So that's one side of the equation. That's one of the reasons if you go and you look at the VIX and it's, you know, still in the 20s, even though the realized volatility is sub 10, that's one of the reasons you're seeing it. Okay. The second thing that's going on is that the weighting in the NASDAQ is skewed. It's significantly skewed. We've seen precedent like this before decades ago, but it's not the same kind of market as it was decades ago because these are high-flying stocks. And there's a lot more options trading going on that's causing individual stocks to see convexity squeezes. Again, normally on its own, it happens sometimes, right? We see it in Tesla. We saw it in Tesla recently. We saw it in Amazon a couple months ago. But because these stocks are so big, right? Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, Facebook, and the Google pair is 50% of the market cap in the NASDAQ. Now, let's go back to our example right here. Let's just say you go buy, I don't know, some Microsoft calls. All right, and then the market maker on the other side ends up short Microsoft. And maybe there's so many calls being bought on all these other stocks, the market makers also end up short Facebook, and then they end up short Apple. All right, we'll just keep it there. Now, because there's not as much demand on the downside, and some other reasons that I can't really talk about right now simply because my brain's fried just thinking about this, what these market makers can do is say, hey, you know what? this basket on its own represents something like 30% of the NASDAQ. So what they can do is that they can go out and buy NASDAQ futures, or they can go out and buy NASDAQ calls, right? And that also adds fuel to the fire, just like we saw in Tesla in 2020. But the difference is this is on an entire index. So the combination of a convexity squeeze, the market cap weighting in these five stocks, and the lack of available liquidity for option sellers is fuel, right? And those three things are causing something where the tail is now wagging the dog. So let's look at the top five stocks right now, right? You've got Apple. Apple went from this, again, post-split prices, 90 to 120 over the course of a month and a half. Since this earnings event, it has just been straight up. Again, it's not a short squeeze because not a lot of people are short the stock straight up. But if you're short calls and then the stock goes up another 5%, you've got to find a way to rebalance your position and get net long. In a normal market, market makers are pretty good with this and they find ways to do it. But because we've just gone straight up, the implied volatility is rising. You have Apple, which is hitting all-time highs, one of the best companies in the world, strongest stock right now. It's a $2 trillion market cap, and the implied volatility right now is 55%. Right? That's how far on the back foot that market makers are, because they are not willing to sell calls unless there is a damn good premium. Okay? Same kind of thing in Amazon. We saw a convexity squeeze in Amazon back in April right here, where it jammed higher, went sideways, and then it rallied, implied volatility rallied, it rallied again, implied volatility is rallying again. Same kind of thing in Facebook. Facebook is squeezing to new all-time highs. Normally, in a complacent market, you would have a lot of people, you know, probably selling calls or things like that, but the implied volatility is 50%. The realized volatility is nowhere close to that. Then you can look at Microsoft. Microsoft just broke out to new all-time highs during that entire time. Implied volatility is going higher. Nobody wants to sell calls right now unless it's a very, very high premium. Then we can look at Google. Google broke to new all-time highs. Implied volatility squeezing. Okay. So those five stocks, which represent 50% of the NASDAQ 100 index, are seeing strong moves higher, both in price and implied volatility. That's not the normal relationship. And it is going on for reasons I just described. There's a lot of people stuck and there's a lot of people buying calls and there's no one to easily balance all of that out. So we're now to the point in which the tail is wagging the dog. And we've seen this before. We have precedent for this. The most recent example, well, it's not the most recent, but it's the most memorable. The VIX exploded higher in 2019. Why? Because there were so many people long XIV that XIV got to such a size that it directly affected the volatility markets. And then the volatility markets directly affected the equity markets. And that's one of the reasons that we saw such a strong rally at the end of 2019, is because anytime we would see some slight pullback, everyone and their mother would get short vol. They would buy the dip in XIV and SVXY. They would short VXX. They would short VIX futures. And it got to such a size that it caused a structural dislocation in the volatility market. Once that dislocation really broke, it crashed the market. Okay. Another example would be back in March, where you had TVIX. And TVIX had rallied all the way up to $1,000 per share, and it got to such a size, the shares outstanding were so large relative to the overall price, that it had a structural risk in the volatility markets, and it caused a crash in vol. Okay, so that's the big risk right now. And here's how this can continue to play out. We've just talked about short gamma, right? Where if a market maker is short 30, right here, and then the stock rallies, they end up short 50. So they have to find some way to balance out the extra 20 of directional exposure that they pick up. Okay. So you've got a couple different things, right? You have your delta, and that's the main thing we want to focus on. What can affect the delta? Well, the change in the stock price can affect the delta, and that's also known as gamma. Okay. And that's the main part of the convexity squeeze. But if implied volatility gets high enough, gamma starts to matter a little bit less, all right? What will happen then is if these stocks start to stall out, Charm and Vanna come into play. So what Charm is, all Charm, we talked about our delta. So the changes in delta as price is gamma. The changes in delta as a function of time is Charm. And then the changes in delta as a function of volatility is Vanna. All right? And no, we're not talking about Wheel of Fortune. So those two things start to matter here very soon, and it can actually, it can really affect how these prices are going to move. So let's just take our example. All right, so you go out and buy a 30 delta call, the market banker ends up short 30 deltas. If the stock stops moving, what will happen is that this curve will change a little bit, right? And it will start to flatten out, especially if it's an out of the money option. As time goes on, an out of the money option will drift towards zero. So let's just say, I don't know, in a week, the delta goes from minus 30 on this to minus 25, which means that the market maker has to rebalance out five shares. And so they can go and they can short five shares, or they can buy puts, or they can sell calls, or they can go and short the NASDAQ futures. And that's how it normally works, right? But because there's such size being played on all of these calls, we're no longer dealing with deltas within a normal range. The directional exposure involved in the options market right now will have such an effect on the underlying that, again, the tail is wagging the dog, that this will become a significant effect, and it can actually cause a flywheel. It can cause a cascade to the downside. Here's how Vanna can work, because what's happening right now is that these stocks are rallying, and then the implied volatility is also rallying at the same time. Well, what happens if it stops working? Maybe the stock goes sideways for a little bit. If the implied volatility stalls out or goes down, out of the money deltas are going to go down as well. So you've got this 30 delta option. If implied volatility goes down, maybe again, it goes to a 25 delta option, which means the market maker is now net long five shares, and they have to either short five shares or short the NASDAQ or buy some puts or sell some calls. If you get enough people doing that combined with profit taking, then you have the mechanism for a very strong rug pull in tech. All right, this is not a fundamental bearish bet. It's not even based off of the overall technicals of these stocks because they're hitting new all-time highs. Overall trend is still up. What we have here is a structural risk because the options market, again, got too big. The derivatives market is too big relative to the underlying. And because everyone's leaning the same way and buying all of these calls, if the tide starts to turn, you're going to see a rug pull. All right, so this isn't necessarily a crash call. I don't think it's going to be like XIV in 2019. It's just you need to think about what would it feel like for you if you saw a multi-standard deviation event to the downside in tech. So some outcomes. Look at some other instances in which we've seen stocks that have rallied hard with implied volatility going higher. All right, so parabolic stocks or parabolic assets where the implied volatility cranks higher while the stock or asset is rallying. 2019 Tesla is a good example of that. 2011 silver is a really good example of that. This doesn't have to be an absolute top call, right? We could just see a rug pull and then a resumption of the trend because the overall fundamentals of these companies are still good. There's still a lot of institutional money that wants to be deployed in these stocks. So it may not be a massive multi-month bear market. It could just be, you know, a rug pull is what I'm calling it. It could be a whimper, not a bang. We could just go sideways. We could trade sideways, see all the options burn off, see a lot of people lose a lot of money just from time decay, and then we can resume the overall trend. We could also carry on further and longer than we think, right? If you look at Tesla, a lot of people were looking for a top in Tesla basically as long as Tesla's existed as a stock. But as you can tell, if you tried to nail the exact top in Tesla, it's been very difficult. What I'm looking for in the potential is that we could see a multi-standard deviation rug pull. Again, not an absolute crash, not a massive bear market, just something to reset the options market because the size of these derivatives is larger than the underlying involved, right? If you have, you know, something like, if you've got, let's just say you have a stock with 100 shares that trade per day, and then the net directional exposure involved in the options market is something like 30 shares, that's going to have an effect in the overall liquidity of the stock. So that's something to think about right now. How would you feel if we saw a rug pull in tech, right? That doesn't necessarily mean, you know, time frames matter. If you're a longer term investor and you can ride the trend, ride the trend. You just got to be ready for a couple bumps in the road. If you're a more aggressive trader, you might want to ask yourself, do I really want to be buying these calls with such a high implied volatility? Are there other ways that I can play these stocks to the upside while mitigating some of that risk? If you want to hedge, you might want to consider, how can I get short directional exposure on the indexes while also getting short volatility? Okay, so that's what I'm looking at. I think we're due for a rug pull in tech. I think that the overall market structure is getting too big for its britches. The tail is wagging the dog. And if the dam breaks, we'll probably see a rug pull. So all I got for now. If you have any other questions, let me know in the comments. Have a great day.